what's it, sir? Because the guideline says that whoever has subscription will be able to live stream. And right now I'm not able to share even my screen also, that what I'm seeing on my video, your screen, I'm not able to share.
Okay.
That's why. But I will sort it out, sir.
No problem. So shall I start the lecture?
Yes, sir. You can proceed. Proceed, sir.
Okay. Right. Good evening, friends. The last time there was a question, how to differentiate between spasticity and a contracture. So someone asked me about R1 and R2. Initially, I was not thinking of taking this topic, considering that probably it will be difficult for you to understand. But now you have asked me, so it's important to explain you in a better way. So we know that the long-term effect of spasticity on a muscle is it leads to contracture. So this process is not a one-day process. It takes around a few months. And how it takes that, we are going to see. So to explain that, first of all, I am showing you a normal range of motion. I am giving you an example of ankle joint. But the same thing can happen at knee also. The same thing can happen at hip also. So let us start with the ankle joint to understand easily. So what you are seeing is an ankle joint, which is in end range of the plantar flexion. So that's a 30 degree of plantar flexion. Now, when we push for the dorsiflexion, the ankle is stretched like that. So the range of motion is 30 degree plantar flexion to 20 degree dorsiflexion. So there is a 50 degree range of motion at the ankle. Now, one thing which is very important is whether we stretch rapidly or slowly, the range of motion will be different in a normal person. So this I showed with a rapid stretch. In that, the range of motion was same. Suppose I apply a slow stretch. In that case also, the range of motion will be the same from 30 degree plantar flexion to 20 degree dorsiflexion. So if you see this in a pictorial form, this is what is shown, that there is a 30 degree plantar flexion to 20 degree dorsiflexion. Now let's go one step further, and whether it's a rapid stretch or a slow stretch, the range of motion is same in a normal person. Okay, now let's take a child who is cerebral palsy child and he has a spasticity. So in spasticity, the behavior of this will be different. The reason is because we know that the one definition of spasticity is it's a velocity dependent stretch reflex. The stretch reflex behavior depends on the velocity. If you give a slow stretch or a sustained stretch, there will be no catch, means there will be no restriction of the movement. However, if you give a fast stretch, then you will feel a catch, means a break at one point. And if you apply a slow stretch, then you will see a further movement from that catch point. And if you apply a faster stretch, there will be an early catch. So in spasticity, the behavior is different, and we are going to see that how that happens. So now we are looking at a spastic child and we are applying a rapid stretch to the ankle joint. So when we apply that at 0 degree, so from 30 degree plantar flexion to 0 degree, the ankle movement takes place. Now you get a resistance that we call it a catch, or in other words, that's called R1 or response one. Now from this point, if you apply a sustained stretch or a slow stretch, the ankle will go into a further dorsiflexion. So on a slow stretch, the ankle dorsiflexion is possible from neutral or a 0 degree plantar flexion to 20 degree dorsiflexion. Now let's see this in a pictorial form. The blue one is a rapid stretch. At R1, we got the catch. And after that, we applied a sustained stretch or a slow stretch, which is shown as a pink. And again, we could reach to the full range of motion, that is 20 degree dorsiflexion. After few months, with a persistent spasticity, there is some development of contracture. And in that case, the behavior will be on a rapid stretch from 30 degree plantar flexion. The plantar flexion is still the 10 degree of dorsiflexion. That's the R1. Now, if you apply a slow stretch now, the further dorsiflexion is possible till 10 degree dorsiflexion. Now, what has happened? The normal dorsiflexion is till 20 degree, but here, even on sustained stretch, the dorsiflexion has stopped at 10 degree. Further dorsiflexion is not possible. So if you see in the picture, the blue one is the normal movement. At R1, there is a first catch. Then we apply a slow stretch. So till R2, there is a further movement. But now you see R2 and the total range or the terminal range, they are different. And the black shows that this is the movement which is lost. And that is what the muscle contracture. After few months or after few years, there is a further development of contracture. And in that case, if you apply a force from 30 degree to 10 degree, there is a dorsiflexion possible. At 10 degree, if you get a first catch, and now if you go beyond, the dorsiflexion is possible till 0 degree. But no dorsiflexion is possible beyond that. If you see this in the picture form, at 10 degree of plantar flexion, there is R1. At neutral position or a 0 degree plantar flexion, there is R2. And if you see the black arc, which is the difference between the terminal range or a total range and R2, that suggests a contracture. So now the question is, what is the practical use of this idea? Why we want to understand this R1 and R2? Or how much is a contracture and how much is a spasticity? Now, for that, let's understand that from the one range to the first catch which we get, that is R1, is a functional range. Child can use that range while carrying out a functional activity. The difference between R1 and R2 or R2 minus R1 is a spastic range. This is a range during or on which the botulinum injection can work and can reduce the spasticity and can bring it to the functional range. The difference between the terminal range and the R2 is called contracture. And if the amount of contracture is more, in that case, we need to consider for surgery. So this is the practical use of this R1 and R2. So I just would like to ask, is it clear or you have still confusion about R1 and R2? And the another point is, like I showed you with the ankle joint, but the same can be applied for the knee. The same concept can be applied for the hip also. So this was just a one joint which I showed you for the example, but the concept remains same. So any question about this R1 and R2 before we go to the next point of management of a cerebral palsy child? Yeah, Shriku, yes, you can ask them.
Yes, anybody wants to ask a question, please proceed. Anybody?
Can I ask a question, sir?
Yeah, yes, please. Proceed. Yes, proceed.
Sir, when we will look for R1,
yeah,
then we have to start from neutral position only, na?
No, when we start from R1, it has to start from a terminal range. So, like if we are talking of a calf muscle, it starts with the terminal plantar flexion, so the end range of plantar flexion. And from that, we go for dorsiflexion. If we are talking of the hamstring, then we start with the full flexion and from that we go to the extension. So whichever muscles we are testing, we have to start from a relaxed position and from that we have to go to the position which stretch the muscle.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, one more doubt, sir. Just R2 and terminal range, once again, just can you differentiate, sir? We didn't get that one point right.
No, I didn't R2 get and, like.
Difference between R2 and the terminal range, TR.
Yeah, TR. So like that is the contracture because the muscle has become permanently short. It's not possible to go beyond that So there is a difference. There is a loss of movement that is from R2 to TR. That movement is lost, and that is because of the muscle contracture.
Then how to get that difference, like R2 to TR only with the release of the muscle?
Yes, exactly. So for the treatment point of view, we are going to come to that, that if there is a more component of, there is like say 20 or 30 degree between terminal range and the R2, in that case, the surgery is the option. The botulinum will not work for that. Botulinum is basically for a spasticity. So when the gap of R1 and R2 is like say 20 to 30 degree, botulinum will work. But if that gap is small, then botulinum will not work. And on the other end, if the gap between the difference between the R2 and TR is more, then that suggests that there is a contracture and that has to be released by surgery. Okay. Yash, your microphone is mute.
Yes, sir. Understood, sir.
Now, Yash, you have probably, Yash is trying to ask question.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So you said so to check the adductors, you mean to, like, we need to go from the adducted position to the abducted position to check for the adduction?
Yeah, for adductors, we start with the midline and then we abduct.
Okay. And for the iliopsoas, from the flex position to extend?
Very good. Yes, exactly. That's right. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Right. That was the question. Yes, sir.
And now the next question, if you want to look at the rectus, in that case, if you want to look the rectus, R1, R2, then how do you check that? Yes, yes, yeah.
Sir, again, rectus, we would... Hello?
Yeah, please.
Rectus again, sir, from the... quadriceps.
With hip, with
again
hip,
from the flexion to extension, it would be
no for
with
rectus.
Hip extension.
With hip extension to flexion.
Yes. So for rectus, we have to keep the patient prone. Start with the full extension, and then you go for the flexion. So that will stretch the rectus.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Any other question?
No,
sir. Sir, to check the adductors, can you repeat, sir, how will we check the adductors in the cerebral palsy patient?
Okay, right. Yeah. So that was the last time we discussed. When we are talking or when we want to check the adductors, we know that there are two type of adductors. Actually, there are four muscles which work as adductor: the adductor longus, adductor brevis, adductor magnus. They are crossing only the hip joint, right? They start from pelvis and they are attached to the shaft of the femur, so they are working only on one joint, that is hip. We have another muscle which is on the posteromedial side, which works as a knee flexors as well as it works as a hip adductors, that is gracilis. Now gracilis is working on hip joint as well as on the knee joint, and because it's a biarticular muscle, it is more likely to be involved in cerebral palsy patient. So to look at the effect of gracilis, what we do, first of all, we examine the hip abduction, abduction, with the knee extended position. So at that time, the gracilis one end is stretched. So you will get a range which you notice. That's, we call it a first part of the test. Now we flex the knee joint. So when we flex the knee joint, the gracilis will be released. So now gracilis is released. Because gracilis is one of the muscles which is likely to be affected, now it is released, it will allow the further abduction to take place. Now, whatever is the difference between the first assessment, that is with the knee extension and the knee flexion, that is the component of gracilis. And that helps us to decide whether to carry out surgery on the gracilis or not. Usually in cerebral palsy, we see the difference of 20 degree or 15 to 20 degree on knee flexion. And that usually suggests that gracilis has to be released during surgery. Is it clear? or still confusion? Nikunj, yeah, Shrikunj, yeah, please, can you ask like
the... Yes, it is, is it clear for you? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please, yeah, is it clear or still you have a question?
Yes, sir, it's clear, sir.
Okay, good.
It's clear, sir.
Okay, so shall we go to the next part of the presentation?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so now we come to the management of child with cerebral palsy. I would always like to say that masters the basics, means understand the basic concept, and definitely with that you can be a master. So this concept which we are going to discuss today, I consider that as an orthopedic surgeon, you need to know at least this much thing about cerebral palsy. And if you know only this much and remember this concept which I am going to tell, at least you will not harm a child with a cerebral palsy. So what is the Hippocratic oath? That please don't do any harm to a person or a patient. The same is the message of this lecture. So in the first two lectures, we discussed that there are various reasons of motor impairments, and the reasons are spasticity, the short muscles or the contracture, joint deformity, the muscle weakness, the deficient selective motor control, and the last time we discussed about the long muscles. Of the six, as an orthopedic surgeon, we can take care of the four, that is spasticity, short muscles, joint deformity, and long muscles. So we are going to discuss how we take care of these four component by our treatment. Let us understand that we cannot do anything for the weakness. Usually the therapist takes care of that. And the deficient selective motor control, again, therapists, they play a very important role in improving the motor control of cerebral palsy child. So now, first of all, let us understand the management of spasticity. That's the first thing. And this is usually the first thing is before contracture, the spasticity is there. Now, we know that spasticity over a period of months, it leads to muscle contracture. So the first aim is to take care of the spasticity. So what are the options we have available for treatment of spasticity? The spasticity is because of the loss of inhibitory control from higher center. We cannot do anything for that. However, we have some anti-spasticity medicine like a baclofen, which works on the spinal cord level, and that reduces the spasticity to some extent. So that is one of the line of treatment which is available, and that is baclofen. But what is more important to us is, in a long term, the spasticity is a devil thing, and that leads to a contracture. So we want to prevent contracture development. How do we do that? The question is, how do we prevent spasticity going into contracture?
Bracing.
By?
Yes, anybody?
Passive stretching.
By stretching. Okay, so now the question is, how do we stretch? For stretching, we have various options available to us. The one is physiotherapy. Then we can prepare some splints which give a continuous stretch to the muscle. Or we can give a plaster cast for 2 or 3 weeks in a stretch position. So these are the three ways by which we can give a slow stretch to the muscle, and that will counteract or counter the mechanism which leads to spasticity, which leads to muscle contracture. So basically, this is a first line of treatment. All three can be done under the guidance of orthopedic surgeon. The therapy part can be done by therapist or family members. Yeah, the second is a splint. We can suggest some device by which we can stretch the muscles, the one which is likely to become short. And the third is cast. The one which is very popular is a botulinum injection. Botulinum became available to us in 1997. And at that point, I was under the impression that now the treatment of cerebral palsy is going to change completely, and probably surgery will be not required in this patient. However, after 20 years, I can say that this is not actually we are able to achieve. So in spite of botulinum, we still see a large number of patients going for contracture. We will see the reason for that. So first of all, let us understand what is botulinum. Botulinum is a neurotoxin. The word neurotoxin is, it works on the nervous system. And the toxin is basically, it's if you give it in a large dose, it can cause a damage. So it's called a neurotoxin. It's obtained from a bacteria called Clostridia. Now, have you heard the name of Clostridia group of bacteria?
Tetanus group.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tetanus.
Clostridium difficile.
And
Clostridium difficile.
Yeah, which in infection it causes. Perfringens. Right, okay.
Yeah.
So, gas gangrene and the tetanus, these are the two major conditions for which we are worried. And that's again by the same group. So, it's basically the Clostridia botulinum is the name of the strain which produces this neurotoxin. This is locally acting paralyzing agent. So, like, it's not like an injection, you give it and like it spreads all throughout the body and there is a widespread effect. No, wherever you give, it will act in the area of 2 to 3 centimeters. So, it's a locally acting medicine or a treatment. This is just a one name. There are various other brands available. How it works? Let's see, understand the mechanism of action of botulinum. For that, first of all, let us understand this neuromuscular junction. So this is a nerve terminal. And on the bottom, the one which is striated is a skeletal muscle. The blue color is called a the motor end plate. So inside the nerve terminal, you can see the green vesicles. These green vesicles contain a chemical called acetylcholine. So when there is a electrical signals which comes from the spinal cord like this, this acetylcholine will be released in the neuromuscular junction and it works on the motor end plate and it causes the contraction of the skeletal muscle. Let's see that again. So this arrow says that the electrical signals, the acetylcholine is released. It works on the motor end plate and it causes the contraction of the skeletal muscle. Now, one important thing, if you look at the junction is having a striated membrane through which the acetylcholine leaks into the neuromuscular junction. Now, when we give botulinum, after injection, the botulinum will spread to the neuromuscular junction, will enter into the nerve fibers, and the fenestrated membrane through which acetylcholine was entering into the neuromuscular gap is now blocked. So now what happens? And when the electrical signals come, the acetylcholine cannot enter into the neuromuscular junction. Because there is no acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction to work on the motor end plate, the skeletal muscle will now not contract. And we have achieved a paralysis of that muscle. So the salient features are, basically it is injected in the affected muscles. If you are thinking that adductors are spastic, you want to relax them, then we have to inject this injection in the adductor group of muscles. It's not like you give it intragluteal or intramuscular and the effect will spread to every muscle. Wherever you want effect, you have to give it in that particular group of muscle. As we saw, it works on the neuromuscular junction. It interferes with the release of acetylcholine. Because of that, it doesn't allow the muscle activation or the muscle contraction to take place. And ultimately, in other words, it paralyzes the muscle. Now we need to understand slightly further, and we are coming to that point. Now I want you to ask, is it a rational treatment? Is it an appropriate treatment to a problem? Shrikunj, please unmute them, and I want to hear their opinion.
No, sir. Yes, yes. Yes, proceed.
Yes. Is it a rational treatment?
No, sir.
Why?
Because, sir, we are blocking the neurotransmitter.
Right.
And that may be the temporary. And, sir, other thing, there may be the disadvantage as well for blocking the neurotransmitters.
Okay, what is the disadvantage?
Sir,
the muscle will not contract.
Sir, the neuromuscular junction will go into a kind of atrophy, non-functioning mode. Because the receptor, down regulation of receptors will happen.
Okay, right. So that is what you said is right. But my question is slightly different. Are we going to, or are we targeting the right problem? What is the problem? Let me ask you something more about the pathophysiology. Where is the primary problem?
In the brain, sir.
In the brain. Very good. Yeah, there is a problem in the periventricular area which block the function of the corticospinal tract. Right. So, why there is a spasticity?
It is a upper motor neural lesion.
It's a upper motor neuron.
Inhibition.
Yes, there is a loss of inhibition. Because of that, there is a spasticity. Now, the question is, does botulinum work on the loss of inhibitory control?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir. We are working it locally. We are not addressing the cause, actually.
Exactly. So, we are not addressing the cause. We are acting locally. So, we need to understand that the problem is somewhere and we are targeting something else. So, let me give you an example. This is an analogy. Suppose you have a neighbor. She is a poor singer. But she has got a karaoke system. And with that system, she sing in a very loud, with a loud music. So, what is the ideal treatment?
The shutting of the electric power.
Okay, the shutting of the electric power. That's a very brutal thing, right? Yeah. Then? So, the best thing is to go to your neighbor, talk to them, your big noise is disturbing me. So, if you want to sing, please sing with a very low volume. That's the ideal treatment. However, instead of that, if we get a headphone which can cancel the noise, surrounding noise, definitely that will solve our problem because we are disturbed by a loud noise. And this noise cancelling speaker or the headphone will solve our problem. But it is not the correct problem. The correct solution is to talk to the neighbor. Either to suggest her that you take a proper class to sing better or sing with a low volume, that is basically the correct solution. But instead of that, if we get a such headphone, we are offering a solution which is not an ideal solution. So similarly, the problem is spasticity, which is loss of inhibitory control. Botulinum does not work at that point. And it creates a muscle spasticity and that leads to additional problem which already you discussed. We are coming to that point. So again, to give you the second analogy, suppose this tap is leaking. Where is the problem?
In the tap.
In the tap. So at the washer, which is not proper, and because of that, there is a continuous leaking of the water. What is the ideal treatment?
Change the washer.
Yes, exactly. So the first is to change the washer. If that is not possible, then you change the tap. So these are the two rational treatment. Instead of that, if I apply a cork over here and stop the water leaking, is it the correct solution? It's not the correct solution. It's a temporary solution. We are not doing anything to the primary problem. We are just doing something additionally so that the problem is solved. So botulinum is something like this. We are not doing anything to spasticity. We are just paralyzing the muscle and we are making the muscle weak. So now before we go to the side effects, let's understand when to use botulinum. Now, at this point, the R1, R2 and the terminal range concept comes into play. We have examined the patient, and in a patient, when there is a large component of spasticity, means there is a R1 and R2 gap is more. In that case, we should use botulinum. So the ideal answer is before the contracture sets in. When the component of contracture is less compared to the spasticity, yes, we can use botulinum. But if component of contracture is more, then botulinum is not advisable and that will not give us a result. So good indication is the gap between R2 and R1 is more, like you can see the pink component is more. This is the best indication for botulinum. If there is a slight amount of contracture, yes, here also, this is one extended indication of botulinum. But if situation is like this, where there is a more component of or a large component of contracture, this is a poor indication of botulinum. So what we understood by R1 and R2 is applied to decide whether to go for botulinum or whether to go for surgery. Any question on that, or before we go to the disadvantage? Yes, Rohit.
Sir, what cutoff we should think of by to decide between contracture and botulinum? I mean, what cutoff of contracture?
Okay, right. See, that's a very good question, but that's a very practical and individual question.
Okay.
The person who is very, who has a very fond of using botulinum will use it even when the component of contracture is large. While the person who is not very fond of using botulinum, with slightest amount of contracture, he will say that I would not like to go for botulinum. Right? So it's an individual. There is no clear cut idea. But okay. You need to see that if you look at the spasticity and contracture component, if spasticity component is more, then you can definitely go for botulinum. If contracture component is more, then we should go for surgery.
Okay, sir. In your view, cutoff contracture should we consider? I mean, 50% of range of motion or 30%, 20% like that?
Okay. That's another very important question. I think we are going to discuss that point about the indication. But whenever contracture is interfering with the range of motion, with the function. So let me give you an example. We are talking of ankle joint.
Okay.
Ankle joint during walking, normal walking, what is the range of motion which we need?
So
normally
20
we
degrees.
Need 20 degree of plantar flexion. And no, dorsiflexion is only 5 to 10 degree.
Yes, sir.
You don't need a full dorsiflexion. The full dorsiflexion is required only when you are squatting.
Squatting.
Right? So when you have this much range, I would not go for surgery. However, when this range is affected, I would now consider that to improve the function, I need to consider for surgical treatment.
Right?
So similarly, we need to look at the hip also. Similarly, we need to look at the knee also. So let me give you another classic example. Let's take an example of adductor muscles. When patient has a scissoring gait, means person cannot adduct 10 degree of abduction, which is required for walking. If I want to walk, I need at least 10 degree of abduction so that both of my knees, they don't touch. So now when this range is not possible, it is a time where you should go for a surgical treatment. Now, if there is a spastic component more, then we go for botulinum. If there is a contracture, we go for surgery.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So now let's come to the disadvantage of the botulinum. The first of all, it's costly. The vial which I showed you cost around 19 to 20,000. And depending on the weight of the child, we may need 2 or 3 vials. So that's a very expensive treatment. Second thing, this the action of botulinum lasts for 6 to 12 weeks, 3 months. So expensive treatment, it works only for 3 months. So that is a really big problem in our country because very few families, they can afford this expensive treatment. And the third is it leads to weakness. It's not a temporary weakness, it's a permanent weakness. And this third effect or a side effect, only last year we realized that this is a major problem for a long-term thing. And I would like to show you the two slides. This is a normal muscle. If you cut the skeletal muscles, this is how it looks. Right? Now, let's see a muscle which has been injected with a botulinum. And after 6 months, if you take a biopsy, the muscle will look like this. Now, what you see white is the fat infiltration, means the muscle fiber has been replaced by fat. If you look at the pink and the violet component, which is a muscle component, it's very small. So this was before treatment. This is 6 weeks after botulinum injection. So what is the conclusion? What do you understand from this?
Yes, anybody?
Sir, even if we achieve anything, but by the time muscles are degenerated, so that will not help us in the long term.
So basically, it leads to a permanent atrophy of a muscle. And muscles are very important. So particularly, we use botulinum for two group of muscles, hamstrings and calf. And both are very important. And if you create a weakness in them, it leads to problem we are going to see later on in the surgical part. This is one of the recent paper which appeared only last year, August. And after that, I have really become very careful. And I don't like to go for this treatment because it may give you a temporary benefit, but this is not going to be recovered in a short term. This may take few years to recover. And this is probably a very serious side effect. And this cannot be seen from outside. It's only when you carry out a study or take a muscle biopsy, you can see this serious side effect taking place. Now, there are few patients, or like there are many patients who cannot afford this expensive treatment of 40 to 60,000 every 4 to 6 months. So in that case, there is another option, which is alcohol. Alcohol, I consider as a poor man's botulinum injection. Alcohol injection is not very expensive. It costs hardly 100 rupees. And you give that injection, alcohol injection, in the muscle. The only problem with alcohol is it's a chemically irritable and it produces induration in the muscles for 4 to 5 days after giving injection. So child will have some pain after alcohol injection, while they will not have any pain after botulinum because it's a water-based injection. So it will not produce any pain. While alcohol injection, it's very good because it's a cost-effective. But the only problem is like child has to have pain for 4 to 5 days. After that, pain disappears. So that was about a spasticity. Now, for the remaining three options, muscle contracture, long muscles problem, and a joint deformity, the only option available to patient is surgical option. Right? When spastic component is there, we can give either botulinum or alcohol. But when there is a muscle contracture, long muscles, or a joint deformity, surgery is the only option. Okay, so now we go to the next point, and that's about the surgery of cerebral palsy. For that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you one patient and we are going to have a case discussion. So the points which we are going to discuss in this is, how does surgery help? That's the first point I will explain you. The second is, what are the common surgeries which we carry out? That we will discuss. What are the results of surgery? Because always family is asking you that whether the child will be benefited or not. So I'm going to show you some example by which you can understand the benefit of surgery. And lastly, the importance of decision making. So these 4 points we will discuss in the subsequent part. So let's start with this case. This case is about a 10-year-old boy, diplegic cerebral palsy. his father is a cotton trading business and the mother is housewife. He has two elder sisters. So he's the youngest in the family and he's a diaplegic cerebral palsy child. And he presented to me and he walks like that. Okay, so let's start a discussion. Where is a problem?
Yes,
what
anybody?
Are the problems?
Yes, residents take part in discussion.
Sir, hip is flexed.
Right, hip is flexed. Okay, very good.
Then sir, quadriceps, sorry. Hamstring is also tight, maybe.
Right, okay.
Knee is flexed and ankle is plantar flexed. So tendo Achilles maybe sir short or tight.
Okay. Yeah, just to correct you, tendo Achilles is a muscle, is a tendon. So what becomes short, muscle or a tendon?
Gastrosoleus.
Gastrosoleus. So correct answer is gastrosoleus. Yes. So yes, there is a hip flexion, there is a knee flexion, there is an ankle plantar flexion. Very good. So we are coming to that before you come to a decision making. Let me ask you a simple question. What is the GMFCS level of this child?
Three.
This is very tricky question and that's why I have put this video. If you try to remember what I said is, if a person walks with a supportive device plus someone's help, then it is GMFCS 4. Now, in this child, if you give a walker to this child, definitely he can manage with the walker or with two sticks. But because there is no supportive device, the child requires mother's support. But this is GMFCS 3 level. Very good. So what is the aim of surgery? Whether it's an ambulatory child in the ambulatory category or a non-ambulatory category?
Ambulatory.
Okay. So what is the aim of ambulatory child? Why we carry out surgery? With what aim?
To improve his gait.
Okay. To improve his posture and his walking or a gait. Right. Okay. So why we want to improve his walking?
So that there should not be fatigue.
And quality of life. Activity daily living and minimizing expenditure of energy.
Right. So basically, we want to improve the walking in an ambulatory child. By improving appearance, we are also taking care of energy consumption. So the child will be able to carry out activity of daily living better and can walk longer distance. That's the aim of surgery. So first of all, let us understand how does surgery works. It's very simple. If it's a short muscles, we make it of a normal length. That is the first thing which we do it in surgery. If it's a long muscle, we make it short and we bring it to the normal length. And if it's a joint deformity, then we take care of the joint deformity. Suppose this child, if he has a flexion deformity, we take care of the flexion deformity. Right? So this is how the surgery works. We try to find out the abnormality and we try to solve that problem and bring it to the normal level. So now, the next thing is you want to decide which muscles are affected. So I'm going to give you the examination thing. His adductors are normal. So he has a functional range, which is not a problem. His psoas is normal. His hamstrings are short. His gastrocnemius is short. The rectus femoris is normal. The quadriceps is of normal length. And joints are normal. So if you look at the from clinical examination, we can identify that hamstrings are short, and the gastrocnemius is short. These are the two abnormality. So what is our line of treatment?
Lengthen them.
To lengthen the shortened muscles.
Lengthen the shortened muscles, right. To bring it to the normal length. Right, very good. So let's go to that, the surgery for the short muscles. We are going to discuss only two surgeries which are very important and more commonly done in cerebral palsy patient, the hamstring surgeries. So hamstrings are on the backside. Usually we look at hamstrings as a knee flexors. So this child is walking with knee flexion and on examination, hamstrings are short. So for many years, we were very aggressive in releasing the hamstrings. And because of that, we used to correct a problem at the knee level. But later on in last decade, we realized that hamstrings has one more function to do. Anyone has idea what is another function of hamstrings?
Extension of the hip joint.
Yes, that's a very important thing, that hamstrings are knee flexors, but they are hip extensors also. So it's not only the gluteus maximus which is hip extensors, but hamstrings are also equally powerful hip extensors. So when you lengthen the hamstrings, you correct the knee flexion problem, but we create something more. What is that?
Hip flexion.
Extensor weakness of hip.
Extensor weakness, and that will lead to our anterior pelvic tilting. The pelvis will tilt anterior. Right? So we realize that hamstrings lengthening is a very good surgery and it corrects the problem at knee. Yes, that's good. But it causes another problem at the hip level, and that is anterior pelvic tilting, which in other words, like when child is walking, it appears that the hip is flexed. So we realize that don't go for aggressive hamstring lengthening. So now the current strategy is that don't go for hamstring lengthening aggressively. Instead of that, what we do is we carry out a surgery, which is isolated transfer of semitendinosus. So what is that and how it works, that we are going to see. So if you look at the semitendinosus, it is also one of the hamstring muscle. Usually it is more affected in cerebral palsy. So in that case, what we do, we detach it from its insertion and attach it to the distal femur. So now what will happen? Now we have achieved a lengthening of the semitendinosus at the knee level, but we have maintained the function at the hip. So we have not sacrificed any muscle which is going to work at the hip. All the hamstrings are going to work at the hip after this surgery. Of the many hamstrings, we have taken only one. Because if you lengthen the other hamstrings like semimembranosus, biceps, it leads to too much knee problem or a problem in the knee flexion. But the major problem is it leads to a hip extensors loss or a weakness, which is a major problem. So how we do it? So this is just to show you that semitendinosus transfer continue to work as a hip extensors. So how we do it? We are looking at the back of the knee. We are on the medial side. There are three important muscles. The one which is superficial is semitendinosus. It has a thin tendon. On the back of that, there is a broad muscle, muscular part, that's a semimembranosus. And on a medial side, there is a long muscle, which is gracilis. So this is semitendinosus. It's inserted into the proximal tibia, or pes anserinus is the insertion. So what we do, we disinsert it from its insertion over here. So now it is not going to work on the knee. We take over this semitendinosus and pass it to the adductor magnus tendon. At the adductor canal, we pass it through the adductor magnus tendon and suture it like this. So now we are giving a new insertion to semitendinosus at the distal femur. Proximally, it is working at the hip level. So this is what the current surgery for the hamstrings. Any question before we go to the next point?
Yes, anybody wants to ask a question?
Niren?
Yes.
This, I'm talking about 30 to 40 years back.
Yeah.
My boss was, he did a lot of cerebral palsy work.
Yes.
He was attached to the unit there.
Yeah, Children's Hospital. Yeah.
And he also used to do this release and put it into the supracondylar area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At that time, we were not doing so most of the muscles we used to release and bring it, but we used to put it in the supracondylar, making a trough and other thing, and periosteum suturing and other thing, we used to do it.
Yes, exactly, sir. That was old procedure. The only difference is what you said is that you used to suture it to the periosteum. Here, they have made it easy attachment around the adductor magnus tendon. So that's the only difference. The procedure is like the Green's procedure, Sutherland procedure, which is 30, 40 years old procedure. But the difference is like at that point, we used to release the semi-membranosus also.
Yeah, yes.
Yes, now we don't do that because we are worried about the loss of hip extensors.
Biceps used to do a fractional release, not a complete release.
Yes. So like for many years, 20 years of my practice, I also carried out a lot of hamstring lengthening by semi-membranosus biceps lengthening. But now we are just doing only semitendinosus transfer. We are not doing anything to biceps or semi-membranosus. So that's the only change I want to tell to the postgraduates.
Now I'm just telling you, the message important is that I have to transfer this.
So 40 years, I think 40 years, this surgery has remained. The only thing technically, there is slight modification to make it easy. Yes, any other question about this hamstring lengthening? Okay, so now we go to one shocking slide. Have you considered an orthopedic surgeon pushing a patient like this? I'm sure that you will not think of that. But now please pay attention for the next 10 minutes. And orthopedic surgeon can be a really brutal like this if he's not careful. So the next 10 minutes is going to be the most important message of my all three presentation. If you forget everything, I will not mind. But the next 10 minutes are going to be very important. So now we are coming to for the surgery of gastrosoleus. So gastrosoleus has two muscles, gastrocnemius and a soleus. Of that, the gastrocnemius is a biarticular muscles and soleus is monoarticular muscle. Now, the popular method for lengthening is a tendo-Achilles lengthening. It's a very easy surgery and I'm sure that after seeing one or two, definitely you can do it also. So in that, you open the tendo-Achilles and you make a Z cut. And you lengthen like this, right? Technically, it's not difficult. The problem is slightly more. We are going to see that. Does tendo-Achilles lengthen one or two muscles? That's the question. Whether the tendo-Achilles has an effect on soleus or on gastroc and soleus both?
Both the muscles.
Yes. That's good. So suppose if you look at the red one is gastroc, the green one is soleus, and the white is tendo-Achilles. When we carry out a tendo-Achilles lengthening, yes, we correct the ankle, but both gastroc and the soleus, both are lengthened. Now in diplegia, we understood something in the first lecture that it's a problem of biarticular muscle. So gastrocnemius is short, but soleus is normal. Again, I will repeat, gastrocnemius is short, soleus is normal. Now, if you carry out a tendo Achilles lengthening, it's going to lengthen both gastro as well as soleus. So naturally, it is good for the gastrocnemius, which was short, you make it normal. So that's a good thing. But what happens to soleus? That soleus, which was normal to begin with, after tendo Achilles lengthening, it will become long. So let's see that first before we understand the effect, the side effect of unnecessary lengthening of soleus. So that's the diplegic child. The red one, gastroc, is short. We carry out a tendo Achilles lengthening. So the gastroc becomes normal, but the soleus, which was normal, has now become overlong. And that leads to a problem because, or before that, let me ask you, what is the effect of that? If you carry out an unnecessary soleus lengthening, what is the side effect?
There may be, sir, weakness of plantar flexion.
Okay, there may be a weakness in plantar flexion. Very good. How much weakness it would create? Any idea? I know that it's a very difficult question, but just approximate, like, what will be the percentage of weakness?
33.
Almost?
33, sir. I guess.
33?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Yeah. So the study which was done in Stanford, that says that if you carry out an unnecessary soleus lengthening, only by just 1 centimeter, in that case, that leads to a 50% reduction in the strength of soleus. So the soleus, which was normal to begin with, by a tendo Achilles lengthening, we give patient a side effect of 50% loss of strength of soleus. So now the question is, why we are really worried about that? Is it really a problem to a patient? Yes, soleus is a very important muscle for humans. For standing upright, like as shown in this, we need a very powerful soleus, because soleus works from behind and it pulls the tibia. And so because soleus is working from behind, it's keeping the tibia upright, person can stand straight. Now, if you create a 50% weakness, this soleus is not able to pull the tibia from behind, and tibia will tilt anteriorly at the ankle joint. And resultant to that, the person has to stand with the knee flexion. So the message is, avoid tendo Achilles lengthening in diplegic child. Please forget everything, I don't mind, but remember this lesson, that avoid tendo Achilles lengthening in diplegic cerebral palsy child. That's the one important message I would like to share with you. So if you do tendo Achilles lengthening in diplegic child, you are pushing a child, and you may lose a child walking ability. So our aim was to improve the walking, but a tendo Achilles lengthening can make patient to walk or to go for a wheelchair for lifelong. I have seen such patients. That's why I'm saying that please don't carry out tendo Achilles lengthening in diplegic children. So now the question is, what we need to do? I'm not suggesting tendo Achilles lengthening. Then what we need to do? The preferred surgery for diplegic is a procedure called Strayer's procedure. I will show you, it's a simple procedure. We go from posterior side, either posterior midline or a posteromedial incision, and we create a gap between the gastroc and the soleus. It's very easily from a medial side, you can find out a plane between the gastroc and the soleus. Once you create a plane, then you identify the gastroc, which is superficial to you, and you cut it. You are cutting only gastroc, And now that corrects the ankle problem. And there is a lengthening which has taken place only of the gastroc. And the soleus is maintained, the strength of the soleus is maintained, the length of the soleus is maintained. So this is the preferred surgery which we usually carry out. So Strayer's procedure lengthens only gastroc, and that is a procedure which is recommended for a diaplegic cerebral palsy child. Okay, any question about this hamstrings or a calf surgery?
Sir.
Yes.
What about that fractional hamstring lengthening? I have heard somewhere, sir. Where does it stand?
Yes, the fractional lengthening we used to carry out for the biceps femoris and the semimembranosus. But as I told you that nowadays we don't carry out lengthening of those two muscles. That's why I have not described those surgeries. In the past, we used to do that. But currently or the recent treatment guideline says that don't carry out fractional lengthening of any muscles.
Sir, thank you, sir.
So these are the two procedures which are very important.
Yes, sir. One more, sir. As we are releasing semitendinosus and we are also cutting gastrocnemius. So What about the knee flexion, sir? Will it go into recurve atom?
Okay, a very good question. We are lengthening the gastroc, but we are not making it overlong. When we cut it like this, the gastroc is going to get attached to the new position.
Okay.
So whatever length is required, that we will achieve. Usually we achieve a 2 or 3 centimeter length by this. But gastroc is going to get attached at new position. And it's going to function. So we are not losing the function of gastroc. We are just making it long.
Yes. Okay.
And there are other hamstrings, the biceps and the semimembranosus, they are still there. We have not done anything to that. So they will not allow the knee to go into hyperextension. When we used to carry out all the three hamstrings, that's biceps, semimembranosus, semitendinosus lengthening. Yes, we used to get recurvator. But now, because we are not lengthening biceps and semimembranosus, we are not facing that problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, one doubt is there.
Yes, please.
Sir, in Strayer's procedure, sir, we cut the aponeurosis of gastrocnemius in transverse fashion, or the complete muscle cut is there and inserted on new place.
Okay. What you are saying is aponeurosis cut.
Yes.
Is basically a Vulpius procedure. So Vulpius procedure and tendoacalis, for practical purpose, they are same. So I am not recommending tendoacalis lengthening. I am also not recommending Vulpius because they are the same procedure. Only difference is the level. But if you look at the mechanical point of view or the muscle effect point of view, both leads to Vulpius and the tendoacalis lengthening, both leads to unnecessary lengthening of soleus.
Okay, sir. It means, sir, in Strayer's, we cut the gastrocnemius completely and reinserted on a new place.
Yes, exactly. Yes. And the soleus is completely, you can see that the soleus is completely normal and you are not doing anything to that.
Yes. Thank you.
Sir, what about Hoch's procedure, sir? Hoch's.
Okay. Hoch's is basically, there are different method of doing a tendoacalis lengthening. White is one. Percutaneous is Hoch's is one. Any of the tendoacalis procedure, whether you do it with open, whether you do it with white, whether you do it with the Hoch, none of the procedure is recommended in cerebral palsy because ultimately it leads to a tendoacalis lengthening. Right? And tendoacalis lengthening releases both muscles. So whether you do it with Hoch, whether you do it with white, whether you do it with the open, all three are bad for diaplegic cerebral palsy child.
Okay, sir. One more doubt, sir. Small.
Yes.
Like adductor release, we are doing. It is not relevant in this situation, but I'm just have a doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Adductor release also, we'll do it complete release, or is it a fractional lengthening, sir?
Okay, that's a very good question. And adductors, there are four muscles. The first is adductor longus, adductor brevis, adductor magnus, and gracilis. We discussed that usually it's a gracilis, which is a biarticular muscle, which is a problem. So we release gracilis completely. right? We carry out a myotomy at the proximal level completely. So yes, we lose some of the function of gracilis. The remaining three adductors, we just release only adductor longus. We don't carry out anything to the adductor brevis. We don't do anything to the adductor magnus. So that, again, the adductor power is maintained. In the past, many of you, when you read Campbell, the surgical treatment is obturator neurectomy. Obturator neurectomy leads to too much weakening of adductors, and in ambulatory children, it is not recommended. Right, so for adductors, yes, adductor longus fractional lengthening and gracilis myotomy is a surgical procedure which we carry out.
Dhiren,
thank you.
Yes, sir.
One important thing, when we used to do LPS, we used to never go deep. It is only a junction of the junction. So we never used to see where is the soleus. It was only a V shape, something like that. We used to cut the... So most of the time, these patients will have some amount of TA tightness. If you get into calcaneus, these patients will never walk.
Yes.
Very important message. If you over lengthen these patients, you have to keep slightly on the tighter side on the TA because they lock the knee with that. If you overdo this, these children, they fall. This is one procedure is very important, and we used to specifically tell that do not over gelisis lengthening of this. Otherwise, knee will lock. The patient who was a walker becomes a wheelchair.
Yes. So in the past, like when I was a student, this was the standard teaching that don't overdo tendo-Achilles lengthening, don't go beyond neutral. The current concept is, again, we are trying to same thing, but we are trying to say in a different way, release only the gastroc, don't do anything to soleus, because soleus is there, you are not going to go in dorsiflexion.
Yes.
But with stiers, there are no chance that you will overdo it.
Yes,
because soleus is there, you are already safe. You have a safety net with you.
Yeah.
Sir, I wanted to ask a question, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, is it that always gastrocnemius is contracted, or we have to do silver skull test and we have to identify whether gastrocnemius both are contracted or only gastrocnemius? If only gastrocnemius is there,
Yeah, very good question. Again, a very practical question. If silver skull test says that only gastroc is involved, surgery is stiers. If it says that yes, there is a both component, in that case, first of all, you carry out a stiers surgery. After that, if you want to carry out a Vulpius lengthening, once you carry out a stiers surgery, you will see the aponeurosis of soleus. And if there is not further dorsiflexion possible, then you can carry out a fractional lengthening of soleus. But that's a very rare situation in diaplegic cerebral palsy child. I would suggest you that don't overdo it. It's always better to underdo it, surgery in diaplegic cerebral palsy child, rather than overdo it. If you underdo it, definitely you can do it again. But once you overdo it, there is no way by which you can bring the child back.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so now we come to the next point, the surgery for long muscles. I'm just going to show you a few pictures so that you understand the concept. When we talk of a long quadricep, this is a normal quadricep. There are two components. On the suprapatellar side, there is a muscle component. On the below infrapatellar side, there is a patellar tendon. So when we say that the quadricep mechanism has become long, actually we are trying to say that the patellar tendon has become long. So the patella is lying at a higher position, which we call it patella alta. So the long quadricep is basically nothing but a long patellar tendon. So for that, we have two options. So now the question is how to shorten the patellar tendon, which has become long. So one is we try to carry out a patellar tendon shortening. And the second procedure is we go for advancement of the patellar tendon, means we take out the insertion of patellar tendon and we take it distally so that patella comes to a normal level. So these are the two options with us. So first of all, let us understand how we do the patellar tendon shortening. So we are looking at the side view. There is a femur, there is a tibia, then there is a quadriceps muscles, patella, and the patellar tendon. So we make a transverse hole in the patella and tibia. So these black holes are a transverse hole going from medial to lateral or lateral to medial. Through that, we pass a strong suture, encircling suture of either Ethibon or a thick Vicryl. This suture is basically to pull the patella down. So we tighten it, and as soon as we tighten, the patella will come to a normal position. What is the normal position of patella? The inferior pole of the patella should be at the joint level. So we bring it to that level. So now you can see that this patellar tendon has become lax. And what we do it, like we plicate or double braced and we suture it. So this is how we carry out a patellar tendon shortening. There are various different surgical techniques. Some people cut it half of the patellar tendon and suture it proximally. Some suture it distally. But ultimately, we are trying to do the same procedure. The another procedure is a patellar tendon advancement, in which we advance the insertion of the patellar tendon. So this is where the patellar tendon is. We carry out the same procedure, but first of all, we detach the patella tendon insertion from the tibial tuberosity with a bone block. So this is how we make a osteotomy and take out the insertion. Then we create a new site distally and we take out a bone block and put it at the original site. Now we bring this patella down and put the insertion of the patellar tendon along with the bone at the new site, and then we fix it with a screw. So that is about the patellar tendon advancement. And the previous one was patellar tendon shortening. Any question?
Yes, anybody?
That quadriceps lengthening can be done with this procedure?
Okay, as I said that when we say the quadriceps has become long, the muscle has not become long. It's the patellar tendon which has become long. So we really don't need to do anything to the muscle. What we need to do is the tendon which has become long, we need to shorten it or we need to advance it. So muscular component, there is no problem with that. It's the patellar tendon which has elongated.
Dhiren, with this quadricep improves quite a lot.
Yes, yes. I'm going to show you, sir, the video. I'm going to show you that.
Suppose you reinforce this because you have a lag. In these patients, you have a lag. If you can transfer some muscles, whether they will be beneficial. Because this lengthening, whatever you have now tightened, over time, these are likely to again have the same, because you are not correcting the pathology of that.
Yes. This is in response to the knee flexion. And once you correct it, that's a very good question. And we just completed a paper and we are submitting that paper to CICOT journal about the long-term results of patellar tendon shortening. And it says that once you correct it, the length of the patellar tendon remains the same for 7 years. We did a 7 years follow-up and that says that whatever shortening you have done, that persists. So what I used to believe in the past is like, once you do it again, you will lose the correction, but it is not like that. The correction which we achieve, that is maintained. I will show you the result also, the long-term follow-up also.
That's good.
Okay, the one question which I would like to ask you is like, I showed you the procedure, patellar tendon advancement. Now, the concern in an immature patient, this is what the immature patient, what is the concern?
Damaging the physis.
damaging the physis. What will happen if you take out a bone plug at this case?
Physiodesis.
Physiodesis. Okay. So what
anterior will the, slope will there will be sloping anteriorly.
Yes. Recurvator. So there will be a recurvator, right? Because the anterior growth will stop, and that the posterior tibia will continue to grow. So there will be a recurvatum deformity, or the slope of the tibia will tilt anteriorly, right? So in children, if we want to do a patellar tendon advancement, we create a same thing, but except taking a bone block, we detach the tendon from the bone, and then we suture with the periosteum at distally. So we don't take a bone, we just take the tendon and suture it with the periosteum, and then reinforce with a plaster for 6 weeks. So this tendon will attach at a new position. Right, and then we suture like this. So that was about the long tendon, the quadriceps. And basically when we say long quadriceps, it's a long patellar tendon. Now we come to the third component, that is surgery for the joint problem. I will just discuss the knee flexion deformity. So knee flexion deformity is something like this, the femur and tibia, the posterior structures have become tight. Ideal procedure is to cut the posterior capsule and correct the knee deformity. However, this surgery is very difficult. Why?
Neurovascular structures in the posterior aspect.
Yes. Yeah, the neurovascular structures are very near to the capsule, and everyone is afraid of damaging the neurovascular structure. So instead of that, what we do it is we carry out a compensatory osteotomy at the distal femur. Remember, the problem is at the joint. We are correcting at a distal femur level. So how we do it? This is what we saw initially. We take out a triangle cut or a bone from the distal end, and then we carry out extension and fix it with a plate. And now you can see that both femur and tibia, they are straight. So this is what we do it in the supracondylar osteotomy or distal femur extension osteotomy when there is a knee flexion deformity. So now the question is, what are the results of surgery? Do we improve the walking? So the case which we saw initially, now this is a result at 1 year. Is he walking better?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir. Now, if you look at his appearance of walking has improved significantly. We underwent, he underwent two surgeries only on both the sides, hamstring transfer and the Schreier's procedure. And now, if you look at the child who was GMFCS 3 has now come to a GMFCS 2 level. So basically, he was able to walk independently, but because of the deformity, he used to require a support. So now we have taken care of the biomechanics. The knee is straight, the foot can be dorsiflexed to a neutral, and so he's walking better.
Sir, gait training was the essential part after a surgery or not?
Gait training, yes. This is basically after extensive physiotherapy for 6 months or sometimes even 1 year. Please remember that when we give a new lens to the muscles, the brain has to learn how to use that new range for the functional activity. And for that, yes, physiotherapy is very important. It's very important. It's not surgery alone. It's surgery plus physiotherapy that gives us result. Okay, now let's come to a case which is much difficult than this. This is a male, 21 year. He completed his Bachelor of Arts with Sanskrit. And this is what he's walking. So now, he is wearing a shorty, but still you can see that the knees are flexed by almost 70 degree. The foot is dorsiflex. There is a flexion deformity at the knee, patella alta or the long quadricep mechanism and the feet deformity. He was advised everything, the surgery for everything. However, the family, because of the certain reasons, said that we don't want to go for the foot procedure. And this is after hamstring lengthening, that's a semitendinosus transfer with the distal femur extension osteotomy, with patellar tendon advancement, and the Stryer's procedure. Now, I just would like to tell you about this boy or this adult. We discuss about the energy efficiency or the energy consumption. And just to tell you about like how much energy he is consuming. This video was taken on 25th of December in Ahmedabad, when the temperature was, the minimum temperature was around 9 degrees Celsius. So it was a cold weather. This video was taken at around 10 o'clock in the morning, walking a distance of 10 meter, or even I would say less than that, 1, 2, 3, 4 tiles, means 10 feet. In this distance, he was perspiring. So that gives you an idea that the amount of energy he was consuming was tremendously high. We perspire after running, but the same amount of perspiration he was getting only after walking 10 feet distance, because his energy consumption was pretty high. And this is after surgery. Again, this video was taken after 1.5 years of surgery. And he again carried out extensive surgery at OTA. And the best part of this is like what makes us proud of pride as an orthopedic surgeon. When he came for a follow-up at 1.5 years, he came by railway. His train was coming on the platform number 6 at Ahmedabad railway station. From that, he got to the bridge. He came to the main station or the platform number 1 walking. So that's the achievement of surgery. And this is what we can do it in an orthopedic surgeon. And this is almost 10 years now. And he's continuing after this surgery. He did his master's MA also in Sanskrit. And now he's a professor at one college. So we can definitely bring change in patients' life. Just to show you the difference in the speed. Look at the speed. It's almost 4 times the original speed. So now just I would like to ask you a question, and family will always ask you this question. Can surgery make cerebral palsy child normal?
No.
No.
No. So the correct answer is no. And please remember, because family will always ask you this question when you say surgery, the child will become normal. Cerebral palsy child, even after surgery, will remain cerebral palsy child. And the neurological problem, we cannot correct. Okay, coming to the last point, now I'm going to take only 5 minutes. The importance of decision in surgery. Surgery is a very powerful tool. Like you showed that it can bring a lot of improvement in the patient. But I always say that it's like a nuclear energy. If you use a nuclear energy in a positive way, definitely it helps us to generate a lot of electricity. It's a boon to us for the mankind, because it's a very easy way of generating power. On the other end, if you misuse it, like Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it creates a havoc. So it's on us how we use that energy or this technique. The similarly, surgery can also bring a wonderful result in patient, but if you make a wrong decision, then it leads to a catastrophe to the patient. So it's very important to decide when to operate and where to operate. I just say that the patient with cerebral palsy, they are walking on a rope. Means they have a very narrow safety margin. If you make a decision, error in decision making, this person will fall from this rope and will go into the place from where you cannot bring him back. So similarly, a cerebral palsy child, if you make a wrong decision, it is very difficult to improve their walking, which is deteriorated after wrong surgery. So a very good sentence said by a famous pediatric orthopedic surgeon, Mercer Rank, decision is more important than incision. I always say that doing surgery in cerebral palsy is not at all a difficult, but to have a proper decision is very important. So where to operate for that, we need to have a thorough clinical examination, video gait analysis or a computer gait analysis, take the help of x-rays or a CT scan for getting the information, and then we need to make a proper decision. Just to ask you a question, where is a problem in this girl?
Hamstring tightness.
Hamstrings look.
Okay, good. What about the ankle?
Ankle also.
No, sir. I guess she's having good heel touch.
Heel touch is lesser than the toe touch, sir.
He's doing heel touch. She's landing on the forefoot.
Forefoot.
So, where is the problem?
Gastrocnemius.
Gastrocnemius, okay, right. And hamstrings, right, okay. So that is what your visual impression is. Let me show you a video slightly in a stop frame analysis. What do you see?
Knee flexion point.
Plantigrade.
The knee is flexed, but the foot is plantigrade. This is right. This is left. Again, foot is plantigrade. Knee is flexed. So the problem is only at the hamstring. But it appears that she is walking with equinus. So let's understand better with this animation. We are looking on the right side from the side and the swing phase. This is how the limb progresses. Right, and for that we need a full length of the hamstring, because hamstrings, the hip are flexed, the knee is extended. So we need a full length of hamstring. Now, when hamstrings are short, knee cannot be extended fully. And if you look at, even with the neutral ankle, it appears that it's in equinus. So this equinus is called apparent equinus. It's not a true equinus. It appears like it's equinus. The primary problem is hamstrings. Now, by mistake, without proper assessment, without analyzing the gait properly, if you carry out hamstring lengthening or a hamstring semitendinosus transfer and even stiers, you make the patient worse. So only surgery which she requires is a lengthening of hamstrings. So in apparent equinus, if you carry out even stiers on the calf, that leads to disaster. And the last point is, at what age the surgery is recommended? There are a lot of confusion, particularly those people who came from the polio era. They said that in the polio, we used to say that the foot surgery has to be done after the age of 12 or 13. And when the polio was eradicated, the same orthopedic surgeon, they started doing a cerebral palsy surgery. And they used to say that don't carry out surgery on a cerebral palsy child till the age of 12 or 13. That's not a correct concept. The current concept is the child requires a soft tissue procedure, means the muscle surgeries, at 7 to 8 years or 6 to 8 years. And the second surgery, which is for the long muscles or a bony deformity or a joint deformity, at 12 to 15. So this is usual. So it's not a failure of surgery. The first stage is for the muscle surgery. The second is for the long muscles and the joint deformity. So this is what the current concept is. Single event multi-level surgery is another popular term, which says that whatever are the problem, try to rectify all the problem in that surgery. That's what the single event multiple level surgery. That is not trying to say that you carry out surgery only once in a lifetime. But whatever you do at that point, whatever are the problems, you tackle them in one stage. Don't go for like one surgery now, after 2 years, second surgery. That's not the aim. So whatever is there, whatever problems are there, you tackle in one go. So that's the end of my talk. Any question?
Sir, one doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Regarding in some deformities, we will go from distal to proximal and proximal to distal. First knee has to be corrected or hip has to be corrected.
Okay. So that's what, for that answer only I have kept this slide, the single event multi-level surgery. It's not like you go from down to up, up to down. Whatever is there, you tackle everything together in one single surgery. If you can't do it, if you are doing single-handedly, if you can't do six surgeries in one go, then do it one today. After 2 or 3 days, do the second. But it's not mean like you do it knee at this stage. After 6 months, you go for the second segment. It's not. Whatever you want to do, carry out everything in one hospitalization.
Okay.
Sir, one doubt is there.
Yeah.
Sir, the case one child which has GMFCS score 3, sir. Mm-hmm. Sir, I'm confused between 3 and 4, sir. In last talk, I understand that GMFCS 3 is always need supporting device. Mm-hmm. And 4 is support device with someone help.
Yes.
I'm confused in this case.
Yes, you have understood it well. So now if you look at this child was not using a supportive device.
Yes.
Now if I give this child a supportive device, either sticks or a walker, definitely he will be able to manage. But the family has not given any supportive device to this child. And they were just giving him a support from behind. So for GMFCS4, it has to be supportive device plus someone's support. So he does not come in the category of GMFCS3. But I'm sure that if you give a walker to this child, definitely he can walk comfortably without his mother's help.
Okay.
Thank
you, sir.
Sir, rectus femoris transfer is also one thing which is described in some of the classes. We are not. We don't know whether when it is used.
Okay. So when first of all, let me say when you need to carry out. When Duncan-Ellie test is positive, you need to carry out. Right. That's the first thing. Now, most of the people, they say that. First of all, you improve the stance phase problem. Means if there is a knee flexion, you correct that. After that, if child requires a second stage surgery, then you go for a rectus transfer. However, some surgeons, they combine everything together and they combine the surgery that is rectus transfer in the same sitting, but it's carried out when the prone rectus test is positive. That is suggestive of a short rectus.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Anybody else want to ask a question?
Sir, is it like any hamstrings, some weakness is there, then we have to transfer the rectus to posteriorly? Is it not? Is it something like that, sir?
Okay. See, rectus transfer is not done for the hamstring weakness. It's basically done for the purpose that rectus is short. So one option, like us, many people, they release it proximally. Some people, they release it distally. And the third group is like they transfer it to the hamstrings. But aim is to relieve the length of the hamstring. So all the three surgery will take care of the length part. It's not to improve the strength of hamstring. It is to take care of the length of the rectus, we are doing this surgery. So we have three options: the proximal rectus release, distal rectus release, and the third is distal transfer of the rectus to the hamstrings.
Okay. And the patellar plication, any other methods are to be done, sir? Patellar plication.
There are various methods, like some people divide it into two parts, some people they divide it into three parts, some carry out VYplasty or YVplasty. So there are various options, but ultimately they try to do shortening of the patellar tendon. So what I showed you is just the simple idea about that, that this is how you can do it. But there are multiple ways, at least I know 7 or 8 methods by which different surgeons they are doing differently. But ultimately aim is to shorten the patellar tendon.
Okay.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Sir, I would like to know about the doses of botulinum toxin, sir, which you earlier said, like, is there any doses value for the injection of botulinum toxin, sir?
Okay, a good practical question. Basically, the dose of the botulinum is decided by two things, three things. The first is the body weight of a child. The second is the bulk of the muscle. So for every muscle, there is a fixed value. Let me say about a calf, the value is 4 units per kilo body weight. So suppose child is 25 kilogram, then 4 multiplied by 25 means you need to give 100 unit in the calf. If it's bilateral, then you have to give it 100 plus 100. If hamstrings, again, the dose is 4 to 6 units per kilogram. So suppose 25 kilogram child, then you need to give another 100 to 150 unit in the hamstrings. So this is how you calculate the dose, and accordingly you prescribe the dose of like the vials of Botox.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, corollary to the same question, sir, do we have to do multiple punctures, or is just one puncture and it will spread all along the muscle?
Yes, a good question. So I told you about one thing only, that the spread of the muscle, the injection is 2 to 3 centimeters. So if I give it at one point, it spreads to 2 to 3 centimeters. So now that answers. What is the correct answer? You have to make a multiple prick.
Yes.
Along the length. If it's a wide muscle, then you have to give it at two place lengthwise also.
Right. Yeah. Sure.
And sir, injection in the bulk, right, sir? Bulk,
yes,
of the
bulk of the muscle, not in the tendon. The tendon is not, does not need Botox, because there is no muscle fiber. So it's only in the bulk of muscle.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Any other query?
I wanted. Sir, polio, sir, as someone asked the question whether be distal to proximal or proximal to distal. Regarding polio, I wanted to ask, sir, is it that we have to do the correction distal to proximal in polio?
Okay, again, like, see, yes, this was, I know it, this is a very popular question of a lot of examiners in the polio era. Again, now my philosophy is like, now surgery has really become anesthesia, and surgery has really become safe. And probably you can take care of all the problems in one go. Now doing a 3 hours long surgery or four hours long surgery is not a problem at all. So the correct answer, according to me, is that you take care of everything. However, in the polio, there is a mechanism which we call it knee locking, the passive knee locking. And that depends on the foot and ankle positioning. So in that case, a lot of people, they used to start with foot and ankle. And once they have a good result, they will go for a knee surgery. Or the some people, they start with the knee, means they correct the knee flexion deformity. Don't do anything to the tendo Achilles. And once you are happy with the knee function, then only you go for a tendo Achilles lengthening, because tendo Achilles lengthening will take away the passive knee extension, which it does it from the backside. So that's why they used to divide it into two, means like stage wise. But I don't think that if you are good at decision making, you can combine everything together. But I think Pachore Sahib will be able to answer that question because he has practiced in that era of polio where the surgery was very popular.
Sir, one thing, sir. Usually in CP case, examiners used to ask, what is Budday syndrome, sir? Can you elaborate?
Yes, Budday syndrome is exactly like the single event multi-level surgery, right? This is the concept. Like the problem is at the, wherever there is a problem, you tackle that. So what was a Budday, Budday syndrome? Means every vacation, the child is admitted in the hospital. So this is like June or a May 2020, you will carry out a surgery at the knees. Then you will carry out a next surgeries in the next vacation. Then you will carry out a third surgery at the third level at the next after that. So every birthday child is spending in the hospital. Or every vacation child is in the hospital. That's why they used to call it, the child is celebrating his birthday in the hospital. So that's the birthday syndrome. The current concept is like wherever there is a problem, you deal with everything in one go. Now, like see, doing surgery in cerebral palsy, one level soft tissue procedure, 20-25 minutes. If you have to do it at hamstring, hip, knee, calf, it hardly takes more than 2 hours. And you can definitely do it safely in the recent days, in the current safety of anesthesia. So that's why the concept came is single event multi-level surgery. This is exactly opposite to what you ask about the Budday syndrome.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, anybody?
And sir, post injection or post lengthening, sir, spleen for 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay. Let me give you my view. There are two views which is prevailing. The first is we know that botulinum is a weakness producing mechanism. Right? Already I described the reason because it causes paralysis. When you give a plaster, that is also a weakness producing mechanism. So my philosophy is I don't want to combine two weakness producing mechanisms together. However, when there is a slight amount of contracture, and if you want to stretch that, you give a Botox, allow the muscles to relax. In the same sitting or after 1 week, you give a plaster in a corrected position so that you get a maximum stretching. So some people, they use it after Botox to stretch the muscle. But as I said, my philosophy is that I don't want to combine two weakness producing mechanisms together. So I don't give plasters after botulinum. But there is another school of thought is like they give plaster after Botox.
Yes, anybody? Okay, Dhiren sir.
Yes.
Okay, so we can end the lecture, sir.
Yeah.
And thank you very much, sir. All three lectures of yours has cleared all the queries and doubts regarding cerebral palsy. They will be the residents will be able to ask any question in practical and theory, sir.
So my aim is to give them a basic knowledge so that they can pass in the exam.
Yes, absolutely.
But at the same time, I have created their thinking process or started their thinking process. So that's most important that they have their questions about the practical usage of this knowledge.
Yes,
and
sir.
Whatever concept, question they have, query they have, they can always write to me by email or the text message. And I will definitely be happy to answer that questions.
Yes, sir. Yeah, yes,
thank
sir.
You.
You have made all concepts clear, sir. During my residency, we used to mug CP. So the concepts were not clear like this, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your time and effort, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. Sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank and you. Good night, sir. Yeah. Good night. Good night.
Good night. Yeah. Have a great time.
Yes, sir. Same to you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you,
sir.